Welcome to St. Paul Church. Glad you're here this morning. I have a few announcements that I do want to share with you. And I'm looking at a clock right now, and it says it's 9 o'clock. Now, I know I was down in Florida for, 6 days or so, and it was on Eastern time. Of course, my watch says 9:30, and it's like, I don't know how to change it. That's really what it comes down to. So, but anyway, a few announcements that I do want to share with you today. Tomorrow at 1 o'clock, we are doing the memories video. So if you get here 1 o'clock or whenever you get there, it will be playing. But Merlin, let me ask you a question. You planning to do it in here or Fellowship Hall? All right. So I just wanted to get that clear. So, and then Wednesday of this week, Women's Fellowship. And so I want to encourage the ladies for that, 1:30. So that's going to be important also. And then I should tell you, Sue and I had a great time in Florida. Very unique situation as far as being down there. The hurricane, I think, was Thursday into Friday. We got there on Saturday. The shopping was actually okay, except we did go to an Aldi, and all of the fresh food was completely gone. All around the perimeter of the store, that was completely gone. But I have to tell you, I'm not sure whether it was because their power went out or whether it was hurricane purchases. And then I got thinking about it, and I realized that the canned goods for canned tuna fish and canned chicken were all there. And it's one of those things where hurricanes, power's going out, I can't imagine you would be getting fresh food anyway. So that might have just been a unique situation. But we had a kid from our youth group from 30-something years ago, and I'm not going to, her age is, a half a century, to give you some idea. And they were in the heart of the situation and were staying in Orlando because they couldn't get into their home. And so then, of course, you saw the news and the devastation. So continue to pray for Florida as well as, of course, South Carolina also, where the hurricane went through. So encourage you to do that. But we had a good vacation. It was relaxing. Sue told me that she would even go with me again there someday. So that's a good thing. So anyway, we're glad you're here. We'll begin our worship service with the ringing of the bell and our prelude. Thank you. I invite you now to stand with me, hymn number 425, In the Garden. I invite you now to join me in the call to worship. Assemble the people, men, women, and children, and the foreigners residing in your towns, so they can listen and learn to fear the Lord your God and follow carefully all the words of this law. Their children who do not know this law must hear it and learn to fear the Lord your God as long as you live in the land you are crossing the Jordan to possess. When the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace and was strengthened, living in the fear of the Lord and encouraged by the Holy Spirit, it increased in numbers. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning to worship you, to fear you, to not be afraid, but to look at you in awe, for you are our Lord and Savior. So bless our worship and your presence here through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. And hymn number 293.
Thank you.
Oftentimes when we hear about how God's creation is reacting through storms and all of those different things, we feel good being safe and secure. In the same time, I always tell people, wherever we live, there is that opportunity for creation to groan, as God's word says, and create havoc in our lives. And so this morning I want to encourage you to pray for the peace that you have experienced in the years. Now, some of you can go back and say, well, yep, I've seen storm damage, I've seen those type of things. And at the same time, pray for those, once again, who have experienced a hurricane. I remember when we were going to Florida, Sue and I were praying that it would go further west. And as we're praying that, my brain's going and saying, all I'm doing is pushing one situation to somebody else. And it's one of those dynamics, as I think through that process, God's grace is sufficient for each of us. Just what happens in life is oftentimes we get inconvenienced by those things around us. So I want to encourage you to give thanks to God this morning for the peace that you have. The harvest seems bountiful. And also pray for the needs of fellow Americans and, of course, churches in the South there that were affected by this storm, that they would have had the right insurance and that they'll be able to find the right rebuilders for them. So let's pray together. Father, once again, we have read about, we have seen on the news how creation groans for that day where you will come back and renew, give us a new earth and a new heaven. But right now, Lord, you call us to be here on earth, and we give thanks, Father, for the peace that we have, the pleasantry that we have, Lord. The harvest that's bountiful around us, Lord. We pray, Lord, for those farmers that you will protect them, Lord, as they reap the harvest and their silos would be filled, Lord, and that you would bless this crop. And then, Lord, we've been made keenly aware of the situation in Florida, South Carolina, as people are recovering from a hurricane. That, Father, you would be their strength. We pray for those who have lost lives, Lord, for those families, that, Father, you would bring comfort to them. We're thankful, Father, that we are a church that wants to rise up and be counted among you as your children. So help us, Lord. Help us, Father, to renew our own lives, to replenish our faith, Lord, to recharge ourselves, to seek to revive our faith, Lord. I pray, Father, for any here today who are wandering in their faith, Lord. They just don't have that same exuberance that they had maybe when they were younger or just maybe a week ago, Lord. And that, Father, you would renew them and that they would be open to receiving your word and that your Holy Spirit would refresh them, Lord. And that, Father, we as a congregation could rise up and be the church that you call us to be. So bless us, Father, and we thank you for the privilege we have in praying together corporately as we pray the prayer you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Haggai chapter 1, verses 12 through 15. Then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, And the whole remnant of the people obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the message of the prophet Haggai, because the Lord their God had sent him. And the people feared the Lord. Then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave this message of the Lord to the people. I am with you, declares the Lord. So the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of the whole remnant of the people. They came and began to work on the house of the Lord Almighty, their God, on the 24th day of the sixth month.
Pray with me, please. Father, we come before you with a desire to hear your voice, to hear your word. And I do pray, Lord, that it's not my words that are going to come forth today, but it's your words, and that your Holy Spirit would work through me, and that each of us, Lord, beginning with me, would hear the voice of God. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So we're still in the book of Haggai, be here for another 3 weeks or so. And I want to again set some historical context for this book of the Bible as we've been doing each week. And so though I decided to take a different approach this time, so I went ahead and looked through my children's Bibles, and I have about 6 children's Bibles. Saw one recently that I didn't have but decided not to get it. And so this now comes from the Eager Reader Bible, and I'm going to share with you the 5 chapters of Ezra. So if you have your Bibles, you won't find all of these words in there. It'll be much briefer than that. But this is from the Eager Reader Bible, and 5 chapters, the first 5 chapters of Ezra. God's people were forced to live in a country called Babylon for 70 years. But God did not forget them. You may go back to Israel, the king of Babylon said. You are free. God's people were very excited. They packed their things and got ready to leave. Their neighbors and even the king gave them gifts. They could hardly wait to get back to Jerusalem. When they arrived, the temple was a wreck. They started fixing it right away. They bought logs from up north. They cut blocks of stone and from out of the ground. Everyone pitched in. Some enemies tried to stop them. They lied to the king and said, these people are troublemakers. At first, the workers had to stop. Now we'll never finish the temple, they said sadly. But then God sent prophets who said, don't stop building. God is with you. The workers felt brave again and went back to work. The king said, it was okay. Sometimes, as I read through the Bible, reading a children's Bible also brings me encouragement. And kids, if you think about it, they can teach us valuable lessons. In the book called Kids Say the Cutest Things About God, here are some things I gleaned from that. I like Sunday school because God doesn't give us any math to do. My boys would love that. If God makes everything like the sun and the trees and the lakes, why can't he make my bed? How many of you have had to make your bed before you went to school in the morning? Yeah, you know, and so you're all saying, yeah, my God should be able to do that. But this is my favorite, and let me look out first. Just gonna check here. All right, we should be okay. God, this is a kid saying, God wants kids to be quiet in church so that we don't wake up all the sleeping people. I should probably put that a little further in the sermon, but that's... We are told we have to have a faith of a child, a childlike faith. So I heard about a story about a young girl who was not going to be allowed to go to the Sunday school picnic because she misbehaved in church. But for the next few days, this precious girl did everything she could do at home. And then mom saw this and she changed her mind. And she said, "You can go now to the picnic." What surprised the mom was is that the girl was not happy. There was gloom and sadness. And the mother asked her the matter. She goes, "What's wrong, dear? I thought you'd be glad to go to the picnic." To which the girl replied, "It's too late. I've already prayed for rain." I got thinking about that cute story, and then I think about, that we would have the faith of a child, that a simple prayer like that, and we would stand for that type of faith. So far, the Jews have not been faithful in this time period of 70 years, and now what they have for the freedom to move on. For our first two studies in Haggai, you really get the sense of a spiritual apathy. Now, the wonderful thing about the book of Haggai is that though it starts on a very negative focus, look, if I was Jewish and reading this, I would be like, "God's really ticked off at me." Pretty negative. Haggai points out the selfishness of the Jews and their neglect of their relationship with God. And the conclusion of chapter 1, as Sue read, is positive and encouraging. The book of Haggai goes on to chronicle the powerful spiritual revival of God's chosen people, a people turning from sin and recommitting their lives to the work of God and what he's called them to do. What's unique about the prophet Haggai is that he is one of the few prophets of the Old Testament who actually witnessed the results of his prophetic messages. You can read through the Old Testament, test me on that. And I have to tell you, as a preacher, Haggai experienced what every pastor throughout the world would want to experience. Haggai's audience had a positive response to God's message that Haggai gave, and Haggai was able to experience, he was able to witness a spiritual revival among God's people. This morning I want to focus on spiritual revival. For our first 2 weeks of Haggai, our focus was brought to us about spiritual apathy. And this morning I want to look at the spiritual revival now and how it happened for the people in Jerusalem and really how it can happen for you and for me. Three things led to spiritual revival in Jerusalem, and the first thing that led to spiritual revival in Jerusalem was the people obeyed. You've heard me say that before, but verse 12, "And the whole remnant of the people obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the message of the prophet Haggai, because the Lord their God had sent him." The people obeyed the voice of the Lord. And how did they obey the voice of the Lord? Well, they first had to hear it. 2 weeks ago, we had looked at verse 5 and verse 7, and we saw the Lord Almighty say, "Give careful thought to your ways." Well, they did that. God's people heard his voice. Now, some will ask, well, did they hear God's voice audibly? And I always tell people, I doubt it very much. You see, if they did, they probably would have been in shock. I always thought, with the, in the microphone in the back and, have somebody, "This is God." I think it would be kind of fun. On the other hand, if I didn't call for that and it happened, I'd be the first one in shock. It's like, that was not my plan, and it would be like, I'm in big trouble. So what did they hear? How did they hear? How did they hear the voice of the Lord? They heard and believed that the voice of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. And they listened to his messages. We can still hear God's voice today. And he speaks in different ways. God speaks to us through prayer. So often we pray and we don't listen. We kind of go through our agenda and say, here's what I need to go ahead and let you know. And there are those times where God wants to speak to us, but we're too busy speaking. He speaks to us through Bible study. Of course, we have to be involved with one or be reading ours. He speaks to us through other believers. And of course, I always say we should use discernment for that. He speaks to us through our conscience. I can just tell you candidly that it's easy to block my conscience. I'd be like, oh yeah, God made it clear I shouldn't be doing this, but it seems so right. He speaks to us through dreams and visions. And I'm a firm believer of that, and we should weigh those against his word. That means when we hear a sermon, when we read our Bible, when we say a prayer, when we listen in Sunday school class or to the sermon, you need to listen for God's voice. In our text, God basically used a preacher to be his mouthpiece, and the people recognized that. But when we hear God's voice, we're told we should respond. In ancient times, two of the most famous speakers were the Roman Cicero and the Greek Demosthenes. They were both eloquent. Someone noted that there was a difference in the results, though, of their address. When Cicero spoke, people said how well Cicero spoke. But when Demosthenes spoke, they said, let us march against the army, against the enemy. They listened and responded. People loved to hear Cicero, but when they heard Demosthenes, they were challenged to move into action. And the action that is required of us today is always going to be obedience. See, obedience reveals that a heart has been broken, that they're willing to serve, and that they're willing to submit to God's calling. It reveals a heart that is repentant. That's what obedience means. That's how it works. We go before God, and we have a desire to change from a sinful lifestyle, and then we are willing to follow God's plan. From our text 2 weeks ago, it would be easy to say that they accomplished this task in verse 8. They would go up into the mountains, cut down the trees that they needed. They'd bring them to Jerusalem. They'd build the temple. That would be the visible part of obedience, but that's only part of it. Their obedience began when they listened to God's word, and then they began to assess their priorities. Before the people could move forward with action, letting God work through them, they had to let God work in their own lives individually. He'd work in them to make a change. Look, if you've been drifting away from God and want to get back into a great relationship with him, then yes, you need to listen to him. And then you need to practice immediate obedience. Take a stand. I have to tell you, good intentions, they don't really matter to God. Only obedience does. Hebrews chapter 3, 7 and 8 says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Take action. That's why he speaks to you. One person once said this, we have only one day to follow God, and it's not yesterday, because that day is gone. It's not tomorrow, because we can't be certain that it will come. All we have is today. When we listen to God, we need to immediately move into an action of obedience. The second thing that led to spiritual revival in Jerusalem was that the people feared the Lord. The last phrase of verse 12, and the people feared the Lord. It's not admission about being afraid of God. They weren't like, oh, I'm afraid of God. The fear of the Lord is an attitude of reverence. It's an attitude of reverence to who God is, what he has done, and that God leads them all the time. Fear of the Lord is loving God with all of our hearts. Love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind. That's the fear of the Lord. Serving him with all of our passion and living in obedience toward him. That's fear of the Lord. In our call to worship, the focus was on fearing God. From Deuteronomy chapter 31, 12 and 13, it's in your bulletin. We heard that fearing God was something that could be learned. I love that. We think it's something that just, it should just come to us. But the fear of God is something that's learned. It was to be taught to the children. In Proverbs 9, verse 10, we see the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of God is understanding. There is a process as God's children that you learn about him. In Acts chapter 9, verse 31, the church is beginning. We have the church, and it's living in fear of the Lord as they did. As they lived in fear of the Lord, they acknowledged the Holy Spirit, and the church grew. And from 1 Peter, we are told to fear God. I was thinking of having you raise your hand, but maybe not. Have any of you received a letter from the IRS? Soon I have. You don't have to raise your hand. Early on in our marriage, after she finished working and we had our first child, we got a letter from the IRS. We didn't do quite something right on her pension programs and her investments. I have to tell you, when I get a letter from the IRS, that is not an envelope that I just put aside and say, oh, junk mail. No. I don't leave it unopened, and I don't ignore it. I open it up immediately, I sit down and I read it, I get my pen or my marker, I highlight the things that it's addressing, important statements, and then if they ask me to send in supporting documents, this isn't in there, but Sue will tell you, I'm not sure where they are. And then I panic. And they're like, I gotta find these things. And I find them, and I copy them. And I'm also well aware of the consequences of ignoring that cute little letter from the IRS. I gotta tell you, last week while we were on vacation, I read over 400 verses about fear in the Bible. I don't know, now I gleaned 411 of them. The majority of them dealt with the fear of the Lord. Other times there were just people who were afraid of God, which I also thought was interesting. People fear God when they don't have a relationship with him, and when those who fear the Lord reach out to them, there's a fear of God that those people have. It's all through the Old Testament. Well, God has sent us a letter through the prophet Haggai, underscoring that we need to fear God. Now, I gotta tell you, I am usually afraid, concerned, when I get a letter from the IRS. But I have to tell you, when I read last week all of these things about fearing God, and in my own life, I realized that when God reveals himself, it is my opportunity to be in awe of him once again. In the 1700s, pastor and commentator Matthew Henry writes, "A holy fear of God will have great influence upon your obedience to him." Continues, "If we fear him not, we shall not serve him." Let me underscore the order in Haggai's message. When we fear and obey, and fear and not delay, then God goes to work in us and through us. Look, Jesus taught the same thing, John 7:17. "Anyone who chooses to do the will of God will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own." Jesus is saying, do the work. Fear him and you will see, and it will be revealed to you. When we obey, when we fear God, God reveals more of who he is to us. He reveals more of his way to us. Obeying God and fearing God, they walk hand in hand. if we decide to do it. And the final thing that led to spiritual revival in Jerusalem was that the people trusted God. Verse 13, then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave this message of the Lord to the people. I am with you, declares the Lord. They heard God's voice and they understood that God was with them. Our first hymn this morning, In the Garden, familiar to many of you. I have to tell you, I keep tracking my hymnal when we sing a hymn. We don't sing this one very often because we often sing this one at funerals. Chosen many, many, many times. But it's a song that says from God, that says, I am with you. Let me remind you, I come to the garden alone. We've all done that. While the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me. And he talks with me. And he tells me, I am his own. I got to tell you, we've sung that at a lot of funerals. But it's meant to be sung every day of our lives because that's what God does. He walks with us. He talks with us. And for me, he tells me that I, Scott Nabestad, am one of his children. I am his own. When we obey, when we fear, he says to each one of us, I am with you. We just need to listen to his voice. There was a family, in the middle of the night, they were awakened by a smoke detector, and there was a fire in the house. The father ran upstairs, imagining my own house. My parents lived downstairs. My sister, my brother, and I lived upstairs. And he went ahead and grabbed his 18-month-old infant, and went into the room of his 4-year-old son, grabbed him by the hand, and on the way downstairs, that 4-year-old went ahead and realized he had forgot his teddy bear. Smoke is billowing in the house. He let go of his father's hand. The grass wasn't there. Dad didn't realize. He's trying to get out of the house. The boy went up to his room to grab his teddy bear. By the time Dad was outside, the fire had blocked the entrance. And now the boy is at the window, and he is crying out to his father, Daddy, Daddy, help me. His father yelled from below, jump out the window and I'll catch you. And in the darkness and the smoke, and the little boy yelled back, but Daddy, I can't see you. And Daddy shouted back, that's okay, son. I can see you. Jump. That story, I've known this one for years, echoes in my head often. You see, there's a saying that says, I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. When we obey, God is simply saying, jump, because I'm right there for you. You may not see, but we're called to step out in faith. Step out in obedience. Step out. That's what he's telling the Jewish people. For 70 years, they were suffering in captivity of Babylon. They knew. I didn't read all the scriptures, but in Jeremiah lets them know that for 70 years, you'll be in captivity. They knew why. Because of their disobedience to God. After 70 years, they wondered if God had left them forever. And they hear these words from the prophet Haggai. I am with you. God is speaking and he's saying, jump, people, do this. Because God has his eyes on you. And they trusted him at his word. I am with you is God's way of telling his people that he's not going to send them back into exile. And that he would be with them right there, right then, and help them with whatever they needed. I got to tell you, when it comes to trust, it always requires action. Not only could the people enjoy God's presence, but they could also enjoy God's power. In the verse 14, we read that the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, Joshua, and the rest of the Israelites. Now, this word stirred up means to arouse, to awaken, to be excited, to be triumphant. There's a win. What we see in the text is that they heard the voice of God. They obeyed. They feared God, and they trusted him, and then God awakened them. He rose up. He allowed them to rise up with his power. He renewed them, and revival happened. And at the end of verse 14, they came and they began to do the work on the house of the Lord. If you recall, you can go back and listen to it, Haggai 1, verse 1, I told you that it took place August 29th, 520 BC. In verse 15, the date would have been September 21st, 520 BC. 3 weeks after Haggai first shared the message from God, revival came and the people served the Lord. It doesn't take a long time for revival to happen. I got to tell you, as a kid, I remember pastors in our church as I was growing praying for revival. Praying earnestly for revival, not just for the church, but for the nation. And it's safe to say that we are a nation that needs a spiritual revival. And I can be bold enough to say that we are a church that needs a revival. And we are individuals that need personal revival. Doesn't take a lot of time. They examined their lives. They changed their priorities. They repented. They listened to God's voice. They obeyed, and they started to fear God again and begin to trust in him. And it can happen the same way for you and for me. This morning we have time. We're going to have a little bit of time. We have communion this morning. And I always remember as a kid when my parents were teaching me about communion, I remember seeing my mom and dad, and I wasn't old enough to get communion, their heads would be bowed, and I remember asking my dad, well, what are you doing? And he goes, well, I'm praying. I said, for bread and juice? Like, for me, it was like a meal, they call it the Last Supper. And he said, no, I'm just going before the Lord and reflecting on my life, what I've been doing for him, and then I'll be ready to receive communion. And he said to me, your mom's doing the same thing. I said, no, I watched. You know, gets communion time, and right away. I said, and he explained, and it was simple. Now, I'm going to encourage you to use this time to reflect on your relationship with Jesus, to listen for God's voice. He wants to reveal things to you. No question in my mind about that. But when he speaks, let him know that you will obey. You're not going to be afraid, but just be in awe of who he is, because he wants to speak to each one of us. And then trust him. Trust him, because he is there. And he just wants you to trust him. Trust him for his presence. Trust him for his power. Trust him that his spirit will give you the ability to accomplish his work in your life. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, we come before you to this table of remembrance. Not like we forgot what you did for us. The Jews might have forgotten. We might have forgotten, Lord, because we just need your refreshment. But in the quietness of our hearts, Lord, as we come before you, Music will be playing. We'll be served. But Lord, if there is a need of repentance, I pray, Father, that those who you speak to will repent of their sins. If there is a need of a fresh glimpse of who you are, that you will once again reveal yourself. Father, if the conscience of anyone here needs to be woken up, Lord, that you'll do that. And that, Father, you will remind each one of us that when we partake of the bread and the juice, Lord, we'll be reminded of what you have done for us. And that, Father, your death forgave our sins. But, Lord, remind us that your resurrection is for us also in heaven. And you sent your Holy Spirit to empower us, Lord, to revive us on this day and every day. So, Lord, when we receive this, they are symbols, Lord, but your presence is here with us. And I thank you for that through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Invite our council members to come up. You'll receive both cups. All are welcome to participate. If you know Christ or are seeking Christ, I'll ask that you hold it, and then we will share in this together. Lord, as I'm hearing Bonnie's music, the final lyrics, "O Lord, have mercy on me." 2,000 years ago, Lord, you had mercy on each one of us. And we're thankful for that. It was at the Last Supper that Jesus took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. It had been a Passover feast before, but he gave it to them and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us share this together. In the same manner, he took the cup, and he called it the cup of the new covenant that would be found in his blood. The old covenant was found in the blood of the Lamb. But behold, our Jesus, our Savior, was the Lamb of God who was slain for your sin and for my sin. And in what he did for us gives us that new hope of the resurrection every day of our lives. What a blessing to share in this together. It says that they sang a hymn following this. I know they didn't sing this hymn, but this hymn is about reviving us again. They would have sang some of the Psalms. Stand together and sing our closing hymn, "Revive Us Again." I pray, Father, that would be each of our prayers, beginning with me, that you would revive me, Lord, a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit. I want it daily, Lord, minute by minute, moment by moment, that, Father, you revive me and revive each one here, Lord, that we would be a church that would grow, Father, because of what you have done in our lives. And I pray this through the word of our Lord Jesus and the power of his Holy Spirit. Amen.